Hello and welcome all. This is a video where I'll try to explain you theory of demand. First, we'll see the definition and the meaning of demand. The definition of a demand run like this, where we say that demand for a commodity refers to the quantity of a commodity that a consumer desired to purchase backed by sufficient purchasing power at a particular price during a given period of time. If you look into this definition, you will find that there are three important keywords. The first important keyword is purchasing power. The second important keyword is price. And the third is time. I can give you one example to explain what is demand and what is not a demand. Suppose if a beggar desired to buy a BMW car, then this wish of a or desire of a beggar is not a statement of demand. It's simply because he does not have the purchasing power or he does not have the money to buy a car. On the other hand, if a rich person desired to have a car, then this statement of him is a statement of a demand. This is simply because he has the purchasing power to buy a car. Just have a look on the slide where one example is given to explain you the meaning of demand in a much better way. It is told that a household purchases 1 liter of milk per day at a rate of rupees 40 per liter. There are certain important things that I want to highlight in this definition to make you understand why it is a statement of a demand and what are the important key features of the definition. The first important thing that is given in the example is the specific quantity, that is how much quantity of a commodity that consumer is willing to purchase. The second important key feature in this example is the price of that quantity of commodity. And the third is the time period is mentioned, that is per day. These three are the keywords, because without this, the statement of a demand is incomplete. I can give you one example that will explain you that why if anything is missing in this definition, then that definition is not a definition of a demand. For example, if the price of milk change, if the price of milk increased to rupees 50, a consumer may not be willing to buy the same quantity of a milk. So therefore, it is not a statement of a demand. So we'll move on to the next slide where we'll see, we'll go through some types. If you look into the types, then there are various types of demand that is generally we discuss. The first category of demand is something what we call individual demand. To be simple, individual demand is nothing but it is the demand made by an individual person in an economy. It may be a individual unit like firm, it may be one person or any single individual. Look at the diagram. If you look into the diagram that is drawn, is something the individual demand curve, that is individual, the upper diagram, that is a downward sloping. It simply implies that when price of any commodity increases, the demand for the commodity decreases. The second type of demand that is explained here in the slide is something what we call market demand. So market demand is nothing but the concept of market demand is like this, that market demand is a sum total of the individual demand. That means you can see in the diagram, I have taken examples like there are three person, Bo, Mo and Joe. Bo is a person who demand 35 units of a commodity when the price is $3. Similarly, at the same price, Mo is demanding 39 unit of that commodity, and at the same price Joe is demanding 26 unit of a commodity. So if we want to find out what is market demand, then market demand is nothing but it will be a sum total of the demand made by all the three person here in the example. So therefore the total market demand of that commodity at price 3 stand at 100 units. So that is what a concept of a market demand. Okay, moving on to the next slide. Look at here, there are three more types of demand that we are discussing. One is joint demand, derived demand and composite demand. Many a time what happened when there are many goods that is available in the economy that we jointly use. Like we may say that these basically the joint demand is a nothing but it is a demand for complementary goods. That is the goods which are jointly demand. For example, car and petrol, pen and ink, bread and butter, and etc. That is given in the slide. Similarly, the second category of demand that is present in the slide, it is derived demand. A little interesting than other types of demand that we are actually discussing. In this derived demand, you see that generally we say that the demand for labor is an example of a derived demand. Why we say it is a derived demand? Because labor is not demanded directly. Instead, its demand depend upon the demand of the commodity in the market. To more precise, suppose if there is a demand for computer, then there will be a demand for computer engineers, there will be a demand for software engineers, and so on. So the complete demand for software engineer or for the computer engineer completely depend upon the demand for computers in the market. One more example you can see on the screen that is given, where we can say like this, that the demand for house will automatically create the demand for house materials like bricks, cement, sand, etc. Right. Okay. Coming on to the last point in this slide, you can see here the word is given, composite demand. Of course, here also we find that there are some commodities like electricity, like milk, that have several uses. So when we talk about those commodities that have several uses, the demand for those commodities is nothing but what we say is a composite demand. So here we have a three different types of demand. Okay. Moving on to the next, you can look here, there are two more types of demand that is discussed. One is called direct demand and the other is competitive demand. If we move on explaining what is direct demand, then it's a very simple concept where we say that the demand for those commodity or goods which consumer directly demand for consumption, these goods are such which is not used for further production, then this type of commodity is an example. This type of commodity falls under the example of a direct demand. Like you can see the examples that is given here in the definition. Food is there, clothes, houses, and etc. Whereas competitive demand is a type of a demand where we say that generally the demand for substitute goods like tea and coffee or like pen and pencil, etc. Why it is called competitive? It is called competitive in the sense that if there will be a change in the price of one commodity, then the demand for other commodity also get affected. For example, if the price of coffee goes up, then some consumer will shift their preference from coffee to tea, and hence the demand for tea will change. So it is not the price of tea is changing, but due to the change in the price of coffee, the demand for tea is changing. So hence, therefore, we say that the demand for such type of commodities which are substitute to each other is basically a competitive demand. Okay, so we'll move on to the next new topic in this chapter, where we'll try to understand factors affecting individual demands, which is also known as determinant of demand, as the heading given in the slide. What is this topic is basically, we are going to discuss here that what are the circumstances or what are the conditions that may come that is going to affect the demand made by a individual. Like the first determinant is price of the commodity. We generally see many people acting like this, that when they go to the mall to buy any commodity, and when they find that the price of the commodity has reduced, they buy more of it. So it's to be and of course in other situation it is reverse. When the price of the commodity increases, we buy less of it. So we can simply say from this point that price and demand, price is one of a very strong factor that determines the demand in the economy. Next we can see here the one of the most important point that if that is a determinant of demand or its affect the demand is something what we call income of the consumer. Income of the consumer, when we discuss about the relation between income of the consumer and the quantity demand, then we cannot simply say direct or indirectly. We have to talk about different types of goods, and on that basis we have to tell that whether the income and demand is directly related or indirectly related. There are some goods that I have taken in the slide. You can see here, normal good, inferior good, and inexpensive good of necessity. Generally, the normal goods are those commodity which is whose demand actually changes positively with incomes. That means if income will increase, demand for that good is also increases. We include luxurious goods like car, clothes, and many other things. So what we see that, and this is the reason that why we see that rich people have more number of car, whereas the middle class people or the poor people, they have a less car. It's simply because their income permits them to have more number of car, whereas for a middle class people, it's really very difficult to have more than one or two cars. Similarly, if we go for the second type of good, then you will find that income and quantity demand is inversely related. This is generally a case of inferior good. In case of inferior good, we see that when income of the consumer increases, he feels relatively richer, and hence he shifts his preference from that commodity to some superior quality of commodity. Examples you can see on the screen, it is jowar and bajra, where when the income of the consumer increases, they try to shift from these type of commodity to some better superior quality of goods like wheat, maize, and many other things, right? The third category that we see here in the good is inexpensive good of necessity. Necessity here implies those good which are important in our day-to-day life, but it is inexpensive. Like we can talk about examples, we can talk about matchbox, salt, and etc. What we see, how income and the demand for these goods are related. When income of these good increases, we find that the demand for these good, or sorry, when the income of the consumer increases, we find that the demand for this good first increases and then they remain constant. So we find that with the change in income, the demand for such good does not changes much after a certain point of time. So we can see from the slide that price whereas an income are two important determinants of individual demand. In case of normal good, income and demand, quantity demand is directly related. In case of inferior good, it is inversely related. And in case of inexpensive good of necessity, we find that first with rise in income, demand increases, but after some point of time with further rise in income, the demand remain constant. Okay, moving on to the next, you can look that point where some more determinants are discussed, like consumer test and preference. This is one of a very important determinant that affect the individual demand. When we talk about test and preference, we can talk about goods like suppose cigarette. What we generally see that when the price of these commodity changes, like cigarette, or we can talk about alcohol, when the price of these commodity changes, the consumer does not changes its quantity because they are addicted to it. So if a consumer is addicted to some good or services, even if the price is changing, they are not going to change their demand. Similarly, we can also say that preferences like social custom, habit, and fashion is there. So during some social festive season like Durga Puja, we find there is automatic, there is a huge demand for consumer, there is a huge demand for dresses, cosmetics, and many other things. So therefore, we can say that test and preference is also one of a very strong determinant of individual demand. Okay, coming on to the fourth point that explain the determinant of demand is price of the related good. Price of the related good, if we are talking, then related good is nothing, but here we are talking about substitute good and complementary good, as explained earlier, that if the price of coffee goes up, then we find that the demand for tea also increases. And hence we see that the price of the related good is also a strong determinant of demand. And in case of complementary good, if we are talking about complementary goods, then car and petrol is the best example of complementary good. What we generally see when the price of petrol increases in the economy, the people shift their preferences from private vehicles to the public vehicles, and hence the demand for private vehicles fall. So this shows that both change in the price of one commodity affect the demand for other commodity. Okay, moving on to the next, you can look here. That one of a very important point that is that affect the determinant of individual demand. The one is called consumer expectation about price, future price. We are consumers are very optimistic. So what they do, they first find out the, they expect the price of the commodity in the future and then they buy the commodity in the present. So if a consumer expects that the price is going to rise in the future, they buy more of that commodity in the present. And in the another situation, if they expect that the price of the commodity is going to fall, then they buy less of the commodity in the present. So this explain that consumer expectation about the future price is also a factor that can affect the individual demand. And finally, coming on to the last point, consumer credit facility is again one of a strong factor that affect the demand. There are many determinants, but we have taken 5 or 6 points to explain that what are the determinants that affect the individual demand. Credit simply means the easy availability of loan. So what we find that when we get easy loan from the bank, we demand more of the commodity. So that shows that yes, of course, easy availability of loan or credit facility also affect the demand of the individual. So these are the determinants of demand that affect the demand. I'll just show you the slide so that we can revise what are the topics that we have done. So we have first gone through a topic where we have tried to understand what is the meaning of the demand and the key features, what are the key points in the definition of demand. Then we have seen the different types of demand where we have discussed about what is individual demand, market demand, then joint demand. Demand for complementary good is actually called joint demand. Derived demand, demand for one commodity due to the demand for other commodity, and composite demand. Then we have also discussed two more types of demand here, that is direct demand and competitive demand. Then we have gone to a new topic, that is factors affecting demand or the determinants of demand, where we have discussed that price and demand is directly inversely related. Income of the consumer is a strong factor that affect the demand of a commodity by an individual. There are some more factors like consumer test and preference, price of the related good, substitute good, and complementary good. And finally, the last slide that we have discussed is consumer expectation about price and consumer credit facility. Okay, so whatever we have discussed so far is actually has explained the factors that affect the individual demand. As I told, it's nothing but a demand made by a single person, single firm, or individual unit. But there are some more points that will make it very clear that market demand, there are some factors that affect the market demand like population. It's written there that increase in the population increases the demand or vice versa. I'll explain you with an example that how this population affect the market demand. If I give you an example where you can find that in any economy, the majority of the population consists of children. Then we can expect that most of the commodity that is available in the market is toys or something like this that is generally demanded by children. Similarly, if we expect that majority of the population consists of female population, then of course there will be a large demand for cosmetics, saris, and many other things. That shows that yes, population is a strong factor that decide the nature of the commodity in the market. Of course, season and weather is a second important factor that affect the market demand. In season and weather, what we see that generally the people do not demand for raincoat during the summertime or woolen cloth during the summertime. It's simply because we do not need woolen cloth in summer. What we need in the summertime is cotton cloth. So therefore, we can say that season and weather also affect the demand in the market. Government policy is a very important factor that affect the market demand. If the government increase the tax on some commodities, we see a rational consumer reduces the consumption of it or lowers the consumption of it. On the other hand, when the government increase the tax, we find that the consumer increases the quantity demand of it. So therefore, tax imposition of tax and lowering of tax is actually inversely related to quantity demand. And finally, we come to the fourth point that explain that how market demand is affected, that is distribution of income. Here, distribution of income simply means that how natural income is distributed or what is the nature of the population, whether the population consists of more of poor people or the population consists of more of rich person. So if you look into our economy like India, we find that in Indian economy, majority of the population is a middle class people. So the types of the good that is produced in our economy is basically a good of necessity than that of the luxurious good. So that shows that yes, of course, distribution of income or the class distribution also decide or determines the market demand in the economy. So this is what actually the factors, these are the four factors that determines the market demand. Okay, next you can see here that is a topic is there that is called demand function. Again, one of the very important topic for your exam. Demand function is nothing but what we say is a functional relationship between quantity demand and the factors affecting demand. We have seen, if I go back, then you can see here that I have shown you lot of factors that affect the demand, like price, income, consumer test and preference, price of the related good, future expectations, and many things. So what actually demand function is? Demand function is nothing but demand function is a function that shows, or I may say, if you look into the third point, then you will find that QD here represent quantity demand. So simply from this equation, an economist tried to explain that what are the factors that can affect the quantity demand. So instead of writing in an elaborate manner, sometime we express the factors affecting demand with the help of a function called demand function, where small p represent the price of the commodity, m is the income of the consumer, and many other things. In general, we represent the quantity demand like QD is a function of price under a condition of ceteris paribus. I'll let you know what is ceteris paribus when we will discuss law of demand. Okay, moving on to the next topic, you can look here, that is demand schedule. Schedule means nothing but it is a tabular presentation of anything. That is what we call schedule in economics. So if you look here, the two types of schedule is discussed, that is called individual demand schedule and market demand schedule. You can look here in this slide. Okay, so I'll first explain what is individual demand schedule. So what we see, as I just now told you, there is a behavior that we see when a consumer go to the market and buy a commodity. Whenever there is a change in price, the quantity demand by the consumer also changes. So to be simple, when the price increase, the quantity demand fall. When price fall, quantity demand increases. So if you can look into the table that is here present, price and quantity demand, you can see when the price was 10, quantity demanded by a consumer is 100 unit. So when the price increase, the demand fall. So when this demand, quantity demand and price relation is represented with the help of a table, then that table is called individual demand schedule. Similarly, when we represent the demand and price relationship of more than one person, that is the demand made by all the people in the market, then that is called market demand schedule. You can see here in the table where a hypothetical example is taken, where the price is 10. At that price, quantity that is demanded by individual A is 100 unit, whereas quantity that is demanded by B is 90 units. So therefore, the total demand for commodity in the market is 190 unit at a price of 10. So when the price change, the demand made by A as well as B also changes, and accordingly the market demand is also changing. So to be very simple, when we represent the quantity demand by all the individual in the economy at particular prices, and we find out the sum total of the demand that is made by the individuals, then that tabular presentation of information is called market demand schedule. So that is what a market demand schedule is. Okay, coming on to one of a very interesting point, that is law of demand. It was given by Alfred Marshall, where Alfred Marshall has tried to explain the price and quantity relationship. Just now I told you, assuming that all other factors that affect demand remain constant, and we call it ceteris, that condition is called ceteris paribus. So let me read this definition. The law of demand states that when all other things remaining same, the quantity demand of a commodity increases when its price fall and decreases when its price rises. You can see here, I have shown with the help of an arrow mark that shows that when price is rising, demand fall, and when price fall, demand rises. And the demand curve is also drawn here, where we have represented price in the vertical axis and quantity in the horizontal axis. And the demand curve is downward sloping, that represent the inverse relation between price and quantity. So this is nothing but the inverse relation between price and quantity is called law of demand, as explained by Alfred Marshall. Here I have we can see that the same slide which we have seen earlier, where individual demand curve is drawn, and at the same time we have drawn the market demand curve. So these are the two different types of demand curve that we see: individual demand curve and market demand curve. Okay, one of the interesting and one of the most important topic for your examination is the reason for downward sloping of the demand curve. Sometime we may wonder that why always the price and quantity demand is inversely related. What are the reasons that price and quantity demand is inversely related? So economists are explaining this with help of 3 points. The first is law of diminishing marginal utility. According to this law, it is generally said that marginal when a consumer continue to consume any commodity, its marginal utility fall. What is marginal utility? Marginal utility is nothing but in economics we say that marginal utility is the willingness of the consumer to pay for extra one unit of commodity consumption. So that means simply, if I leave it up to the consumer, then the amount of money that the consumer is willing to pay for the extra one unit of consumption of any particular commodity is called marginal utility. Okay, this topic we have in the next chapter also in the consumer theory. So we'll go to this point in an elaborate manner. Let us first only go through some point where I'll try to make you understand that how law of diminishing marginal utility explain the inverse relation between price and quantity. Right. Okay, let us take one example to explain this point. Suppose if a person go to the market to have a cup of tea. So for the first cup of tea that a person go to the market to have, he is ready to pay 10 rupees. So definitely his desire to have a cup of tea is fulfilled. So therefore, for the second cup of tea, he may not be willing to pay the same 10 rupees, but instead he may be ready to pay only 8 rupees. So what we see that for the second cup of tea, that is quantity demand is increasing, his willingness to pay, first it was 10 rupees and now it is reduced to 8. So his willingness to pay reduced. Therefore, willingness to pay reduced means price has reduced. So when price has reduced, quantity demand has increased. That explain the inverse relation between price and quantity demand. There are two more points that explain the reason for the downward sloping of the demand curve. One is income effect and the other is substitution effect. In case of income effect, how we explain that price and quantity demand is inversely related? By taking one new concept that is called real income. So real income is nothing but it is actually the amount of commodity that a consumer can demand with a given income and price. Okay, let us take one example. You can see here one example is given on the screen. Suppose a consumer buy 2 liters of milk at a price of 50 rupees per liter. So does he spend 100 rupees on it? So if a consumer has 100 rupees in his pocket, so he is able to buy 2 liters of milk when the price of the milk is 50 rupees. Now the question is, if the price of milk fall to 40 rupees per liter, therefore in this situation, a consumer can buy the same quantity of milk at a less by spending less amount of money. So here you can see that according to the calculation, he has to spend only 80 rupees to buy 2 liters of milk. So with the extra money that he is saving, that is the 20 rupees, he can use that money to buy more quantity of milk, or he can use the money to buy something else. So what we see that if the consumer buy more quantity of the milk with that 20 rupees, then we see that with fall in the price from 50 rupees to 40 rupees, the quantity demand of the milk increases. And finally, we come to the last reason that explain why demand curve is downward sloping, that is called substitution effect. Substitution effect is nothing but it is actually a relationship, means it is a relation that is explained among the substitute good. So it's very simple. So we have already gone through this topic where I have explained you that how substitute good affect the demand for another commodity. Like for example, if the price of coffee will increase, consumer will shift from coffee to demand. Consumer may feel that coffee has become relatively costlier and so they will shift their preference from coffee to tea. And as a result, what we see that the demand for coffee will increase and the demand for tea will increase and the demand for coffee will fall. So this explains that how the substitution effect is responsible for downward sloping of the demand curve. So this is what, so we'll end here today, and next video, I'm going to show you some more things, some more reasons of explaining why demand curve is downward sloping. So Okay, so you all please go through this video, and if you find interesting, we'll continue further.